A warm welcome to all our invitees and participants attending today's sessions on shaping the future with renewable energy India by 2030. I must praise the organizer for such kind of webinar, an interesting topic since the sector is in paradigm shift, or we can say the turning point where we are experimenting a lot with business models, technical experimentations, innovations in project management, scaling of solar applications, which has driven the tariff below 2 rupees. So as per the utility scales of solar projects are concerned, it is very much crucial for the capacity boost on the Indian power sector. But we should not ignore the decentralized renewable energy, as it is rooted to renewable energy rural populations. So many of India's most underserved people today lived in countries' climate vulnerable regions with climate access and healthcare, education, and livelihoods. The poor are among the least equipped to cope up with the climate change threat, despite being overrepresented in climate vulnerable areas. So in India, poor and marginalized communities faced the dual challenges of low socioeconomic development and extreme vulnerabilities to climate change. Yes. So providing reliable access to electricity through decentralized renewable energy creates an opportunity to stimulate low carbon socioeconomic development in climate vulnerable regions such as rural part of India. Here, although there has been a significant improvement in India's rural household electrifications, almost 97% as per latest figure, 97% rural villages has been electrified. But still, the quality of the power is an issue, and the power that they get are intermittent. So electricity availability for health centers, schools, rural enterprises are very, very limited. What we are trying to say is electricity is one of the key enablers of socioeconomic development. It has access to reliable electricity, as can improve the working hours of the staff, availability of water, diagnostics services in hospitals, improve the learning environment of schools, increasing the school attendance and the quality of education deliverables in schools, and enhance the productivity and income of rural livelihoods. So here in decentralized solar energy solutions are increasingly considered for bringing reliable electricity to community facilities, especially in climate vulnerable areas. Although decentralized solar solutions are not entirely immune to extreme events, they are relatively more resilient to the centralized electricity systems, like the existing grid solutions we do have in our society. As we know, the Paris Agreement that has been signed on 2015 governs the framework of a standard sustainable development goal 13, and requires all signatories countries to seek promote low emission resilient development pathways that limit the temperature rise well below 2 degree, or ideally 1.5 degree centigrade. So to achieve this target, all the countries need to inevitably decarbonize the existing energy system and shift to cleaner energy. Decentralized renewable energy technologies highlighted in the report published by World Bank proved to be an alternative to conventional sources of energy, while also reducing the level of emissions. So here in India today, we are facing a dual challenge of meeting its development goals while also reducing the climate change impact. So this decentralized renewable energy can contribute to both goals by providing opportunities to power healthcare, educations, and livelihood in communities most of the risk from climate related effects. So what exactly we are talking when we say it's decentralized renewable energy? So here I have distinguished the electricity access applications into three segments: health as well as education and livelihood. So in the health sector, access of electricity can affect working hours, staff availability, quality of services, water availability, medical diagnostic services. So a study in Maharashtra recently on electric outage frequency and maternal health service usage found that improving electricity supply may increase the institutional delivery rate, like in maternity wards, and improve the overall maternal health outcomes. So another study is exploring factors, what they are saying, that they influence women decisions regarding their place of child delivery, found that in good infrastructure, including electricity supply, water, clean toilets affect of women's satisfactions of their services while they are going for delivery in the maternity ward and in public health center or any small rural hospitals kind of things. So here we have various kind of applications that we can see: vaccine refrigerations, portable maternity kits, baby warmers, centrifuge for blood analyze. So when we take the samples of blood, we need to keep on centrifugal so that it won't get clotted. So yes, that is again applications. And yes, there can be applications in solar power operation theaters. So in education sectors, access to electricity can influence the learning environment, school attendance, most importantly, and the availability and quality of educational services. Access to electricity can contribute positively to education's outcomes through better living conditions for students, teachers, and school staffs. It can improve the likelihood or livelihood of that particular children, especially girls who are attending complete who are attending the schools, by enhancing the access of clean water, sanitations, lighting, space heating. So in cooler environment, we can get this kind of, we can do space heating solutions for the states where there is extreme temperature, like 2 to 3 degrees of centigrade. The children has to go to schools and sit and attend for the lectures or classes. And electricity and can also provide opportunities to use the teaching aids for equipment such as computer, projector, or science equipments. So as here in livelihoods, what we can say for farm-based livelihoods, energy is relevant to the entire value chain for productions and marketing. At the production stage, it is widely acknowledged that mechanizations of activities such as sowing, irrigations, spraying, and harvesting, such as can improve farms and labor productivity. However, only 40 to 45% of agricultural sector is mechanized in India. A survey estimate suggests that the untapped market potential for mechanizing of the productions level, not only the irrigations part, I'm excluding the irrigations part, through clean energy is close to $30 billion. And now you can imagine like what kind of potential we have. Access to reliable electricity plays a crucial role in wide range of non-farming activities, such as manufacturing, process heating, cooling service, cooking, informations and communications technology, mechanical processing industries, manufacturing, as well as the repair industry. So reliable electricity is particularly crucial for small business, which unlike larger establishments cannot afford backup power generators. So in 2019, study by Selco Foundations in Bangalore documented 65 micro enterprises experience found that the sustainable energy solutions help them to add more product and services were otherwise available to them due to lack of reliable electricity supply. So we can understand, we can clearly understand that how, what kind of necessary is there for to electrifying the rural areas. So this is my a brief study for the next 5 slides. I will be showing you each and every applications and what is the total installations. And here you can see we have considered only the Maharashtra state of for micro cold storage, and subsequent slides will talk about the other applications where you can see the other states we have considered, what are the major players, typical system costs, key financer available in the market currently, what is the market potential. This is very important. So we have identified the market potential, and what are the impact of livelihoods. So that is again monthly data per month, how the it will be getting impacted to the livelihoods and the SDG impact. So here, though there is an established network of cold chain infrastructure, they mainly focus on distributions and large scale storage. This makes inaccessible to farmers looking for storage post harvest, forcing them to sell their perishable product immediately after harvest. So micro cold storage address this type of discrepancies. So a dried produce can be stored for longer durations, as we all know, to about 12 months kind of durations, and thus can be sold at a higher value, which could otherwise fetch lower prices in harvesting season. Solar dryers provide a more efficient and faster method of drying as compared to sun drying. So the traditional process for sun drying, which is the traditional process of food preservations. So going back to the next slide. Yes. So most rice mill in India is done through the diesel powered. The farmers paid a major of their income, majority of their income, by on buying diesels, which cuts at their savings and profit. Solar powered rice mills provide a cheaper alternative to diesel powered rice mills in the long run, while increasing output at the mills at the same time. Solar refrigerations provide a way in which rural enterprise running cafes or small petty shops can store their cold and chilled food items like cold drinks or paneer, buttermilk kind of things, which are easily perishable in the normal summer and temperature. So not only do they prevent wastage of such food items, but also allow the entrepreneurs increased income because of better food variety. In addition, solar power medical freezers cater to rural need of immunizations for vaccine and blood bank collections. So that is again a huge area of applications. So in India, decentralized dairy industries, keeping milk fresh is a priority. So it is it needs to get refrigerated within a few hours after milking due to unreliable rural electricity, which may dairies depending on the expensive diesel generators. So solar powered and thermal storage are the solutions to reduce the milk wastage. So here we can use that solar technology for chilling the milk or to preserve the milk. Yes, in spinning industries as well, because we know the manual work required for reeling the yarn in a form of thick silk reeling is a slow process. So it limits the productivity. Solar power spinning and reeling machines overcome these challenges while positively impacting weavers' livelihood. So especially in the areas with limited electricity access. So these are based on the investors' interactions. So when we interacted with the lot of investors and funding agencies or the financing institutions, an analysis of the policy landscape are reported challenges. The following these are the recommendations. Following are the recommendations and the key challenges that we can address are very critically. So the key challenges that lack for adequate process amongst mature organizations. So lack of scalable business models, that is very very crucial nowadays. There is a risk perception among the financier due to high dependence of enterprises and government subsidies. And the Indian governments are kind of they are restrictive norms. The norms are restrictive in nature for investments by the foreign funding institutions. So competing government policies, a low awareness regarding emerging technologies. So there are a lot of emerging technologies around there throughout the R&D centers or the premium institutes like IITs, NITs. They are doing a lot of research, but this kind of research are not coming to the ground because of lack of knowledge or kind of they can't at this point that is not scalable. So that is again a key, those are the key challenges. Whereas what we can do as a way forward to bridge the finance to bridge the finance to address risk related to delay in the subsidies disbursal. So yes, that we everyone knows that what happens when we talk about subsidy in solar sector or in renewable energy sectors. So yes, so the risk mitigations mechanisms need to be done. So what sort of risk are there? Whether if we are supplying power to the rural households, so those households are whether those households are they can pay the tariff properly or not. So that is again risk. Support for new and emerging business models, long-term patent model, patent capital for investors to scale up. Yes. Just a second. So explicit recognitions of solar power applications for rural livelihood schemes. So we need to recognize that what sort of applications can drive their livelihood in such a way, whether they will profitable enough to do this kind of service. And yes, obviously, since because it's an the economy is not great as we are talking about the utility scale solar power plant in city or large investors are coming. So we have to depend on the subsidy initially, unless and until this business model is scalable and we can reduce the cost. With so that to come cope up with other technologies, we need to depend on the subsidies. Thank you so much. This is a brief presentations within a short span of time what I prepared and try to convey my decentralized solutions and role towards this webinar. Thank you so much.